client on the resin, and you can see my contact data here, and as well as with previous presentation, you will be able to find all the examples in my GitHub account. And I also work for Data Art. And today I'm going to tell you about validation of the request data for the REST API endpoints. Let's get started. We now have it in, even in presentations. Okay, so what does it mean to validate a document? Well, obviously it simply means to make some decision whether to accept this document or to reject it with some explanation. Usually it's a list of validation errors in some form. But what are the criteria, what can be the criteria of acceptance of the document? What validation rules can be there? Well, in some cases you just need to validate the format of your fields. For example, that the email should be in appropriate format, or that the age should be saved in a non-negative integer. Or in other cases, you might need to validate some business rules. For example, that, that the age should be at least 18 is clearly a business requirement that comes from business. Okay, so you have your REST API endpoint. You received a JSON document, you mapped it to some data transfer object. What's next? How can you apply your validation rules? One way is to use bin validation. It's a standard specification in Java defined by several JSRs. And its certified reference implementation is called Hibernate Validator. When you are using this tool, your validation rules looks like this. So as you can see, you can use constraint annotations. So you are describing your validation rules declaratively, which means you don't specify any sequence of actions. You don't write an algorithm which validates your document. Instead of specifying what to do, you specify how to do it. This declarative approach has many advantages. You can, if done properly, your code will be readable, it will be maintainable, you would be less likely to introduce some complicated bug. But is it true for the really complex cases when you have some difficult validation logic? Of course, each tool has its limitations, and if your validation rules are complex enough, you can end up with unmaintainable mess and lose all the readability of your code. So, but at some degrees of rules complexity, you can still use Hibernate Validator. So let's find out when can we use it and when we should think about some other solution or some other approach. So I will show it to you by example of a small data gathering service which will collect the job applications for space pilots. So it would be, it will be one REST API endpoint which accepts or rejects the JSON document with job application data. So let's take a brief look at the API. So in order to show you API, in order to demonstrate it to you, I've created a contract definition. So when we are sending a valid document to this URL, we are receiving a status created and some IDs payload. And when we are sending, oh, okay, thanks for pointing it out. Let me, okay, now it should be visible. Okay, so now it's visible. Okay, so let's get back to our success scenario. So if we are sending the valid document to this URL with post method, we are receiving created status and some payload. And if we are sending invalid document, we are obtaining bad request status and some validation errors in the payload of result. So if you want to, if you don't know what the contracts are and interested in what it is here, you can look up Spring Cloud contract, but next we will focus on validation, on how we are obtaining these validation messages. So as of now, this application doesn't have any validation logic implemented yet. I will do it together with you. And we will use a test-driven development approach. And it will be already familiar for you, Spock, here. For those who are watching this presentation on YouTube, I hope it still will be easy to grasp what's going on, because Spock is quite readable way of writing the tests. So we have a test specification for our component, which invokes the validation logic. So we given some job application, it's a DTO, which we obtained from the controller. Given this job application, let's see how it looks like. So just a simple plain Java object with name, surname, position, country, some years of practice, and etc. So far we have a set of test cases only for successful path, which means that we are checking that if we are passing valid document to our validator, it will not produce any validation errors. So we can see that given some job application, when we are passing it to validation handler, we are expecting that the map with validation errors is empty. And as a data source for the test in this where table, we have two documents. One is for the pilot, and second one is for the captain, because our application can accept people for these two positions, pilots and captains. Let's take a look at how we are creating these data sets. So I'm using Groovy Map, which was already demonstrated to you by Mateusz, in which we are specifying the data for this object. And so I'm creating the pilot from scratch, and I'm creating the captain by replacing several fields from the already prepared pilot map. So I'm changing the position, I'm increasing the years of practice. Of course, captain should be more experienced, and captain also has a new parameter, has ship. Okay, so let's define our first validation rule and write the test for it and implement it and check that the test passes. So we can use the similar structure for tests which check the validation messages. We should rename it. Should fail for some field name. Here we, just as in previous test case, we are taking this job application from the data source of the test. We are passing it to the validator, validation handler. And now instead of checking that the errors map is empty, we need to check that for this field field name, it contains some error message, which we will provide in the data source of the test. So we don't need the captain for now, because so far we will be focusing only on pilots, and then we will add some tests for captains. And we don't need the document name anymore, because we are naming our test by the fields. I think it will be enough for this presentation. So let's define our first validation rule. Let's start with something trivial. For example, that the name field should be mandatory, meaning that if we are passing the pilot without name, we should expect some validation message like please specify your name. Okay, how can we create an instance of pilot data without name? We can use this left shift operator and set the name to null. We also need to provide field name and the message. Field name would be name for this first validation rule, and the message would be please specify your name. Here we can format it just to make it a table again. And of course this test case would fail. Let's make sure that it happens because we don't have this validation rule implemented yet. So as we can see, our first two test cases which accept the valid document without any validation errors are passing, but our new test case is failing. Okay, let's implement this validation rule. It would be a trivial task to do. There is a standard annotation not blank that appeared in bin validation to zero, which not only checks that the field isn't null, it also checks that it's not empty and has something else other than space characters or tab characters. So we can now specify that if this annotation not blank is, if the name isn't present in the job application, we should tell please specify your name. And now we can run our test once more. And we can see that all cases are passing. Okay, so we've defined our first validation rule. We write a test for it, and we implemented this rule, and we checked that the test passes, and also we checked that our validation logic don't break accepting the valid document. So let's define similar rules for the rest of the fields. Won't take much time. Surname, position. Rest of mandatory fields, because some of the fields can be don't have to be mandatory. Years of practice and country. Specify your surname. Here we will be a little bit different. Let's tell us about your practice. Let's specify your country. And here it should be country. So let's format this code. We have now we have more test cases. Let's make them pass in one go, not waste time on it. We can just copy paste this annotation and change the message. And here in for integers we cannot use not blank annotations because it's applicable only to character sequences, so we should use not null. Thank you. Oh, we will see it in the tests. Okay. So here this by your okay country. Name. And did I change it? Ah, country name, okay. Okay, so now we've made sure that our mandatory fields are validated well, and we can define one more, little bit more interesting validation rule. So let's take a look at the position field. Here we can see that for the pilot it's pilot, for the captain it's captain. So let's define that it's the only possible values for position. So for example, if the position is passenger, we you should tell the client that there is no such position. Okay, now we need to implement this validation rule. And in standard bin validation toolbox, there are no annotations to specify a set or a list of allowed values. So let's create our own annotation. Would be named one of values captain pilot, and the message would be, let's copy it. There is no such position. So now we should create this annotation. Okay, I've modified my standard default template for the annotations to have all the needed boilerplate code already here. So what we are defining in these annotations. So we've defining our new annotation. We are telling Java that JDK or JVM that it should be applicable to fields. It should be available. It runs in the runtime. It should be repeatable. So it means we can have more than one annotation over the one field, and it should be validated by some instance of constraint validator. That it's in fact a constraint annotation, which is validated by some validator. And it also has a set of standard parameters, which should be present for every annotation, for every constraint annotation. So each annotation should have message. We can specify groups for them. And also, I will get to groups later. And there is also a parameter payload, which goes a little bit beyond this talk. And here, there is some necessary boilerplate for ensuring this repeatable functionality. Okay, so we need to add a new parameter, values. So now we can see that in our DTO, it should be an array of string, of course. We can see that in our DTO, this annotation is compilable. So let's, and one thing which is left is to implement in this validator. It's an implementation of standard constraint validator interface, which is parameterized by two types. One is the type of the annotation we are using, and the other is the type of the fields to which we can apply our annotation. And in the initialize method, we can use constraint data in order to populate some fields of our validator to use it later. And in the isValid method, we are making our important decision whether to accept this field or not. So let's agree that we will use the set of strings which we will use to validate the method, and we will use them from the constraint parameter. All we need to do is to create this list as a field. Create field, and that should be a set of string. Okay, so now we are all set. And before we use our set values to check if our validated value is one of these values, I would like to ask you, what should we do with empty values? Should we, so this isValid method should return true or false? Obviously, it returns true if the object, if the field is valid, and it returns false if the field isn't valid. So what should we return for the empty value? Yeah, it should. But anyway, any values would be automatically handled by all annotations. But yeah, you... okay, so when we are receiving empty value here, should we return true or false? Yeah, correct. It's yeah, you can... Okay. Yes. As it was pointed out, we already have not blank annotation in which scope of responsibility is to test whether or not this value is blank. So that we can assume that we should bother ourselves only with non-empty values or non-blank ones. And so if we are receiving blank values, it means that we should just ignore them. But what does it mean to ignore value in a validator? It means to return true and forget about it. Oh. Well, it just means that in our so that this field isn't mandatory, and we still shouldn't check in this annotation that it's not blank. So that we can either make field mandatory or not. So if it's mandatory, we should check that it's not blank. But if it's not mandatory, that it means it can be null or empty, that means that one-off annotation should not reject it if it's blank. So we should return true. Well, if we want to, we can, but it's better, in my opinion, it's better to separate this by using different annotations. And I think I can give this cup to you because you said that we should separate this concern, and actually it's part of right question. Since that person who answered gave the final answer already has one. Okay. So let's return true if this field is blank, or we can return true if our set of values contains this value. Okay, so we've implemented our validator, and now we can run the tests. Yeah, I have a rather convenient position because if for some reason test fails, I can always say that I did it on purpose to demonstrate you how not to do it. Okay, but so far I didn't have to. Okay, so let's implement a new validation rule. It would be quite similar to the previous one, but a little bit different. So what if we are sending a non-existing country? So we also should inform the user that there is no such country. So for example, if user sends country as Narnia, we should tell them the bad news. There is no such country. Okay. So how can we implement this validation rule? We already have one-off annotation in which we can list all the existing country, but I don't think it's a good idea. So let's create a new annotation which would be specifically for countries, like country message. There is no such country. Okay, now we can create this annotation. So we don't need to change anything because we don't have any additional parameters. We already have them. And so how can we do this validation? We even don't need to initialize our validator because there are no parameters to initialize it from. So let's suppose that our application obtains the list of existing countries from some external web service or from the database or from some other external source. And for this example, for us, it means that we should use some Spring Bean for it. So we should access some Spring Bean instance from the validator. Can we do it without resorting to some not good practices like having some context util from which we can get the bin? Of course, we can. We can make our validator a bin itself, and when the Hibernate validator is integrated into Spring context, it will resolve it from the Spring context rather than creates a new one. Okay, so we can make it a public class, country validator. Let's make it a Spring component. And now we can inject the bin which we can use. In this project, in this sample project, we have some space service which impersonates all the Spring services which we could have, possibly. Let's inject it via constructor injection. Auto-wired. And now we can ask our service to whether or not the country exists. Again, we first should ignore the empty or blank values. With blank, we should return true. Or we can ask our service, already has the method, country exists value. And all we need to do is to specify the stub behavior for this service, because in our test specification, this space service is mocked. So here we can write that space service country exists. Let's think how should we specify this stub. So as we can see in pilot and captain data, we have United Kingdom as a country. So let's make it return true for United Kingdom, so that our valid document would still pass validation, and it will return false by default, because it's default stub behavior for if you don't specify it otherwise. And now we can try to validate it or to run the tests. And it's passing. Okay, so let's now there is a time to remember about our captain. So as we can see, for the captain data contains the field has ship, which is not present for the pilot. So let's make it mandatory for captain. And so, for example, that if we have a captain data without this field. We should ask them about it. Please tell us whether you have a ship. Let's copy it. I will not able to reproduce it once again. Ship. Okay, so now let's take a look at our DTO object. So we have this field has ship, and we have this position field, and we should validate has ship field only if the position is captain. So unfortunately, we cannot write an annotation for the has ship on the field level for the has ship field, which would take a look, a sneak peek at position, because if we take a look at the validator signature, we have only value which we are validating, and we don't have an object to which it belongs, so we cannot even use the reflection for it. But there are still at least two ways to do this conditional validation. Maybe some of you knows how can we do it. Yes, that's one of the ways, and I think you can take a cup. And there is also other way which can validate a document depending on some condition. Yes. Who was it? Okay, so it's also for you. Okay, so I will demonstrate you both ways, and let's start from class level annotations. So let's create the annotation not null, no, conditional, not null. Conditional, not null. Which would validate the field named has ship, but only if field position has value captain. I hope this API is quite readable. So we are validating field has ship if field position has value captain. Message should be this one. Okay, and now we can create this validation annotation. Validation. Okay, so now we should change this target type to type, because now we are applying this annotation to the class. And here it's also should be type. Now it's compilable. So we should add all the parameters we've defined: string, field, string, if field, if field, and string has value. Let's check that it compiles. It compiles. Okay, we can mimic. We can copy the structure to the validator itself. We also should change the parameterization of the validator. Now it is applicable not to the strings, but generally speaking to the object. Okay, and so here we should also change it to the object. Okay, now we can use this and this variable fields. Let's make them private. And let's initialize these fields. So that field equals to from constraint. Constraint field, if field equals constraint if field, and has value equals constraint has value. Okay, and now we can use reflection to make our decision. So first we should obtain the value of the field which we are validating. So it could be object field value equals to, I've created a utility method which uses reflection to get the fields of objects. I also heard there is such things called bin util, but it throws exceptions, and in order to not to bog you down with this exception handling, we can just use the version which swallows exceptions. And we need to know the actual value of the if field, so let's name it really has value. Could be get string field, because now we know that it should be string, and if field. So first of all, we should return true if has value isn't equal to really really has value, because it just means that the position value is not captain. In this case, we should not validate, and in turn, it means that it means that we should return true. So if has value isn't equal to really has value, we should return true. Or we should return true if the field value which we are validating isn't null. So objects not null, field value. Okay, and the question for the license. Is everything okay with this implementation, or we forgot about something? So will this validator do what we expect of it? Oh, by the way, yeah, but it's my fault. Maybe conditions should not be flipped, but we should return true if they are not equal to each other. But it's okay, so assuming that the validation logic is correct, if this logical expression is correct, now I can see that it's correct. What have we forgotten? Yeah. So that in our test specification, we are expecting that this error message please tell us where you have a, whether you have a ship should be alongside this field has ship. But in our DTO, it is on the class level, so that Hibernate will not have a clue where to put it, but it will put it somewhere. Let's find out where. And this is the moment when I can run the failing test and say it does on purpose. Okay, so what happened here? So let's see that. Let's make use of the Spock expressibility of error reports. So this error map has this contents. So it has this application message, but the field name is empty. And that's why this condition isn't satisfied. So in order to, so we can fix it. In order to do it, let's take a look at how our validation handler class is implemented. It's not a big deal. That's why I didn't show it from the beginning. It just uses Hibernate validator and transforms the output. So we are injecting Hibernate validator instance here. We are pass the, our job application to the Hibernate validator's validate method, and it returns the set of constraint violation parameterized by type of our DTO. And for our convenience, we are transforming this set of violations into the map. And as a key of this map, we are getting this property path, which is constructed by Hibernate using the names of the fields respectively. So in our case, when we don't have nested objects yet, the property path consists just of the name of the field which we are validating. So we somehow need to populate this property, the part of this property path, the property node. And we can actually do it with, so let's, instead of immediately returning the result, let's first save it in some Boolean variable. Is valid equals to, is equals to this, and return is valid. And if it is not valid, we should change this constraint violation automatically generated by Hibernate. For this, we can use this context. Let me show you how to do it. I've used a template. I do not waste time. And first, we are disabling the default constraint violation which is created. And the next, we build in the constraint violation from the default template. But we are just changing this property node, which is part of this property path. Which we are using to populate the key of our map, and we are creating it as constraint violation. And now it should work properly. Okay, now it works. And what about the validation groups? I've promised you to show them as well. So here for the years of practice, we can see different values that the captain is like is expected to be more experienced than the pilot. So let's define that the captain should have at least 4 years of practice and pilot at least 2 years of practice. So let's remove one of them. Years of practice, if we are saying like 3 for the captain, we should receive the error message. Not enough practice. And for the pilot, we should receive that error message only if the years of practice is 1. And we can implement this validation rule now. And also, we should remember that all other tests should work. So now we will not use class level annotation. We will use validation group. We have a standard annotation min, which can specify a minimum value for the field. Message should be not enough. Yes, if I didn't make it not enough practice. Okay. what on a practice. And we also need to specify the validation group, groups close to pilot class. We will create this group in a minute. And for the captain, the minimum value should be 4. And actually, the groups are just simple Java interfaces. They are not meant to have any implementations. They are just markers for the group, for the groups. So we can create pilot, and we can create captain, interface captain. And now we need to pass the group to the Hibernate validator. So the validate method has a signature that it can accept some amount of groups. We need only one for now. So let's create a method getGroup, which will accept job application and return the group to which it belongs. Create method, it will return class, job application. Okay, let's make it the most easy way and easiest way. Captain. If captain equals to job application get position, we should return captain. Otherwise, we should return pilot. And let's see what happens now. So there will be another surprise. So on one hand, something works properly, that our valid documents are still valid. And for the years of practice for this limit, the validation works. But what happened with all other annotations, with all other test cases? Well, when we are asking Hibernate to validate against this or this group, we are actually telling it to ignore all the other annotations. So these annotations, like one off, not blank, etc., they will not be taken into account. So how can we fix it? There is a standard group which is called default, which is added by default implicitly when the annotation doesn't have any groups assigned to it yet. So that, and we can simply pass this default group to the validate method, and it will tell Hibernate to validate also the default the annotations with default group as well. And now we can see that all tests should pass. And there is other way to deal with this situation. We can still pass only one group, but we can use the fact that the groups support inheritance, so we can extend both groups from the default. And now when we are asking Hibernate to use, for example, pilot group, it will also use a default group as well. And now we can see that it works as well. So just, well, yeah. And getting back to our DTO. So this class level annotation has some disadvantages. First of all, the typos like this are not detectable in compile time. Until you are executing your tests, you will not see that something is wrong. For example, you wrote ship again instead of ship, and it will compile. And the other problem, in my opinion, is more important. One is that now, if we are looking at has ship field, we are under false impression that it doesn't have any validation annotations on it. So in order to see all the validation rules for this field, we should look into different places of our code, and it actually reduces readability and maintainability of our code, of our definition. But on the other hand, for example, here you can specify some complex scenarios, more complicated conditions, not just the position is kept, and you can have a list of some values of some logical expressions, etc. And when it comes to groups, So it in this particular case it's fine because all the validation rules for the years of practice is near these years of practice, and we don't need to look into other places of our code. But and in this particular case, the group, it's quite easy to guess what the group means, right? Because we can just see that it can be either captain or pilot. But for example, in your real cases, you can have the groups which are so. On the one hand, you can play with different combinations of groups, because here, as the name of parameter implies, you can specify more than one group, and in this method, as we already saw, we can pass more than one group. So you can really have some clever logic here on one hand, but on the other hand, if this logic gets too clever, it means that some amount of your validation logic resides even beyond your DTOR, and you again need to look into different places to see what is going on. So, and to sum it up, if your validation annotations look more or less like in this example, probably Hibernate Validator is right tool for you. But if you have too much class level annotations like this, if you have really complicated groups and etc., and for example, in some heavy cases, you even might need to repopulate some data which don't come from the JSON just to help your validators to use them. Then probably it means that you might need to change your approach to use some different tool. And well, which what are the different approaches? You can just use imperative style, probably in some cases. It would be more readable than this declarative one if the logic of validation is clearly imperative, can be easily formed as an algorithm. Or, for example, you can still be declarative but define your old DSL, which is specific to your project, to your domain, and you can just somehow specify your validation rule. Or, for example, if you are a fan of true object-oriented programming, you can have clever data transfer objects, which will not just hold the data in some metadata with annotations, that will be able to validate themselves. Why not? Okay, so that's it from my side. Do you have any questions? Okay. Okay, thank you. It's a good question. So in this example, I didn't show you how we can use resources for specifying the messages, just to save time and to make the examples contain all the information to see. But of course, in real projects which are intended to be used internationally, you can. So instead of specifying the message in a plain text here, you can use a template name like. Job application surname, and if your application has a resource file with lines like job application surname equals something something, it will be resolved automatically, and you can provide the information how to which language to use basically. So it's not a problem. So you mean this value? Well, it's also some kind of limitation. So you can use only constant values here. Or maybe it can, but I haven't used it in practice. So. Thank you. Okay, and once again, why don't you like adding this login to the validator itself? Okay, you mean standard ones. Well, maybe there is a way, but I didn't have this necessity, so I don't know the answer. Context? Yeah, but I've already demonstrated it. When we creating the, oh, maybe I didn't make it clear. So that when we've constructed this property path by specifying the property node, we actually used the context. So the context is the entry point to play with the constraint violation, which is a result of the validation. So that so here when we had this conditional not null annotation, in which there is no clear way by default to hibernate to see to which field it should be applied. We specify in this field building a new constraint violation instead of default one, and we are using context. Okay, so thank you for your attention.